Section 8.2, more on limits of sequences. So in my mind, sections 8.1 and 8.2 are really just one big section. And whereas section 8.1 was the introduction to sequences with the background and the theory, 8.2 is more the nuts and bolts section that's concerned with finding limits of sequences. And so the only new ideas or new material really boils down to just three items. So let's list those quickly. Number one, let's put this under the heading of limit properties. And these are the same old properties that you've seen many times before in other contexts. So in this case, we're talking about sequences. So suppose A sub n and B sub n are two sequences. Let's say convergent sequences. Say A sub n converges to L and B sub n converges to M. Then let's say item A, the limit as n goes to infinity of the sum of those two sequences is the sum of the limits of those two sequences. In fact, let me include that as an intermediate step. So, of course, it's that same old property we've seen many times before. Initially with limits of real valued functions, and then with derivatives, and then with integrals, because they were all really limits. And so the same principle applies here. The limit of the sum of two sequences is the sum of the limits of those two sequences. And of course, if this was a subtraction, the same thing would apply. Okay, so what are the other standard limit properties? Limit of a product of two sequences will be the product of the limits of those two sequences. And of course, notice here we are saying that these limits exist. They are real finite values. So we're not talking about something like infinity times infinity or zero times infinity or any of those other unusual forms and sometimes indeterminate forms. So no big surprise here. Limit of a sum is sum of the limits. Same for the difference. Limit of the product is the product of the limits. Limit of the quotient is the quotient of the limits, provided the limit of that B sub n sequence is not zero. And then, of course, the simplest of all the old limit properties is that when we take the limit of a constant times a function, or in this case a sequence, that's the same thing as that constant times the limit of that sequence. Okay, so nothing surprising here, but obviously basic tools that we need to manipulate limits when we're trying to find them. Item number two is the sandwich theorem for sequences. Of course, the logic behind this derives exactly from the sandwich theorem for real functions. Namely, if, let's say, A sub n and B sub n and C sub n are sequences such that, let's say, A sub n is less than or equal to B sub n is less than or equal to C sub n for, let's say, sufficiently large values of n. So what I mean by that is this inequality or pair of inequalities doesn't necessarily have to be true for n equals 1 or n equals 2 or even up to maybe n equals 100, but it has to be eventually true. there has to be some n value. Let's say it starts happening at n equals 1,000. And then from that point forward, it always has to be true. So that's, of course, what I mean when I say sufficiently large values of n. So if that's true, and the limits as n goes to infinity of a sub n and c sub n both exist and are the same number, then of course what we're going for is the limit as n goes to infinity of that sequence that's trapped between those two, that's sandwiched, is going to have that same value. It exists and is also equal to L. Now let's go to the next page for the last one. So item number 3, another old result that you're familiar with. If f of x is continuous at L, and the limit as n goes to infinity of a sub n equals L, and f of n and what I really mean is f of a sub n is defined for sufficiently large n. Okay, so let's look what we have so far. F of x is continuous at this number L. The limit of my sequence a sub n is also that number L. When I try to plug the values of the sequence into f, I will actually get answers. It's defined for sufficiently large n. In other words, eventually, all of these f of a sub n values are defined. If that's all true, then the limit as n goes to infinity of f of a sub n is equal to f of the limit as n goes to infinity of a sub n, which of course is f of L. This is always a pretty innocent looking theorem, almost one that doesn't seem to say very much, except it's really important. This is the one, for example, that says if I want to take the limit as n goes to infinity of the square root of n plus 1 over n plus 2, this theorem is the one that allows me to look at the limit as n goes to infinity of that radicand, that thing that's sitting inside the square root function. And then if that limit exists, which of course I know this limit is 1, then really what I can do is take this square root function and move it outside the limit, which is exactly what this line above is saying. It's saying this f, which is on the a sub n inside the limit, can be pulled outside the limit, and now I have f of the limit of what was inside f of x. And so when I had the square root in here before, that square root function was like the f. And now I have pulled that square root outside the limit, which means that function is now outside the limit. And that means I get my answer, which is square root of 1. This is the theorem that allows me to extract functions outside the limit like that. You've used this before, if you haven't been thinking about it. The last place we used this idea with real valued functions is when we had the limit, let's say as x went to infinity of a function, and there was some indeterminate form like 1 to the infinity or infinity to 0 that arose from that, then of course our trick was taking the ln and raising e to that ln, and of course that's the same thing as limit x goes to infinity of f of x. Okay, what was our little trick? It was to look at just the limit x approaches infinity of the ln of f of x. And we got away with that by pulling the e outside the limit. So we were actually using this idea or this theorem even when we were using that trick. And so, armed with these limit properties and what we learned in the previous section, along with tools like L'Hôpital's rule, let's just go through several examples of finding limits, which is what the homework in this section is concerned with, finding sequence limits of various types. So I'm just grabbing a bunch of even problem examples from the book. So here's a sub n equals n plus negative 1 to the n over n. Okay, so I'm selecting some examples here to point out specific approaches and things you should be aware of. So for example, with this one, if I try to plug larger values of n in and figure out what happens, well, of course, this n gets larger, this n gets larger, the ratio of those two is 1 to 1, but then, of course, there's this negative 1 to the n that alternates back and forth between plus or minus 1. Notice L'Hôpital's rule can't really apply here, because for one thing, I can't take the derivative of negative 1 to the n. So I have to think about some other approach. And so what are the other tools I have? Well, I have my basic limit properties. I have the sandwich theorem. And the sandwich theorem, if I think about it, is exactly the right thing to apply, because I know this sequence equals one of two things. A sub n will be equal to n plus 1 over n if n is even. But I know a sub n will be equal to n minus 1 over n if n is odd. And anytime I see a part, a factor, or a term in a sequence that looks like negative 1 to the n or negative 1 to the n plus 1, I should keep this in mind, that this really reduces to two simple cases. And so I should write those out to see what I've got. Well, it seems pretty clear now that for each value of n, the largest possible value my a sub n could be is n plus 1 over n, and the smallest would be n minus 1 over n. And so when I hear largest and smallest, that immediately makes me think of the sandwich theorem. I know now that the largest a sub n can be is n plus 1 over n, and I know the smallest it can be is n minus 1 over n. But I know the limit as n goes to infinity of n minus 1 over n, and the limit as n goes to infinity of n plus 1 over n, both by L'Hôpital's rule, are limits of 1. And since a sub n is trapped in between those two, I can say by the sandwich theorem that the limit as n goes to infinity of a sub n is also 1. If you're going to use the sandwich theorem, make sure you show me what the two things are that you're claiming this basic sequence element falls between, and then clearly show me that those two limits are equal. Now, in this one, there isn't much to show because it's a super easy application of L'Hôpital's rule. Sometimes showing these two limits are equal to this common limit is not as trivial. If it is fairly trivial, then you don't really need to show me any more than what I've shown you here in this example. Okay, so there's a typical example of an instance in which I would apply the sandwich theorem. Let's look at a sequence like a sub n equals 2n plus 1 over 1 minus 3 squared of n. Okay, so when I start thinking about what happens with larger values of n here, well, I see the top goes to infinity, and I see the bottom goes to negative infinity. Okay, that does automatically make me think about L'Hôpital's rule. And so I know formally I should be replacing those n's by x's so that I'm dealing with continuous functions. But we'll go ahead and fudge on that and just look at the limit as n goes to infinity of our sequence, and I'm going to apply L'Hôpital's rule on these n expressions, And so when I take the derivative of the top, I get 2. When I take the derivative of the bottom, I get negative 3 over 2 square root of n, which means if I clean things up a little bit, I've got the limit as n goes to infinity of, it looks like, negative 4 square root of n over 3. And as n goes to infinity, this definitely goes to negative infinity, which means this sequence diverges. So obviously some of these sequences are going to diverge. The question will be, do they diverge or do they converge? If they converge, what is the limit? Okay, so this last one was just an example to remind us that we can use L'Hopital's rule, and we will have to use L'Hopital's rule frequently. Here's another type of sequence we see quite often. A sub n equals negative 1/2 to the n. Of course, if I write out a few sequence members, a sub 1 would be negative 1/2, a sub 2 would be positive 1/4, a sub 3 would be negative 1/8, a sub 4 would be positive 1/16. And by the way, when you look at one of these, if you're not immediately sure what the behavior is, that the first thing you should do absolutely is to write out 4, 5, 6 enough terms in the sequence at the beginning to get some idea of what the pattern is. And by doing that, I can clearly see in this example that the signs are alternating, but the absolute value is definitely getting smaller, and it's getting small quickly. Now, I can't, again, really just do something like L'Hopital's rule, but I could certainly do the sandwich theorem again. And I can do that in a really simple way. I know that a sub n at most can be a positive 1/2 to the n. And I know at the least it could be negative 1/2 to the n, which of course is exactly the same as what I would get if I took negative 1/2 to the n. Okay, now at this point, it really is trivial for us to say the limit as n goes to infinity of 1/2 to the n is 0, and so is the limit of negative 1/2 to the n. And since both of those limits are 0, that tells us that the limit of the a sub n, which is trapped between, is also 0. So another simple application of the sandwich theorem. Let's try this one. A sub n equals sine squared of n over 2 to the n. Okay, again, when I think about what happens to the numerator and denominator as n increases, the bottom definitely increases quickly. Now the top, if I think about the sine squared function, I know sine is periodic and it ranges from negative 1 to 1. So as I plug in increasing values of n, it's clear that this numerator is just sort of going to wander back and forth between negative 1 and 1. It's not going to trend towards any particular value and get closer to it and stay closer to it. All right, so this is where I pull out an old result from Calc 1, and this is a good problem to use as a reminder of this so that you have this tool. So there was an old theorem we proved back in Calc 1 that said if the limit as x approaches infinity of a function f of x was 0, and g of x is less than m for sufficiently large x values, then the limit as x approaches infinity of f of x times g of x is equal to 0. To put that another way, if the limit of the f function is 0 and the g function is bounded for sufficiently large x, which is what this part, which is what this part says. If I say the absolute value of g of x is less than m, that's the same thing as saying g of x is trapped between m and negative m, which means g is bounded. It's no larger than m, no smaller than negative m. And in fact, if I knew g of x was positive, I could actually say from this that g of x is greater than 0 and less than m. And we proved this in Calc 1, but it should be plausible to you. If I know this thing has a limit of 0, and I know this thing is bounded in size, what happens when you take something bounded in size, let's say something that can never get larger than m, but you multiply it by something that's getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller? Well, something bounded by something that's getting smaller and smaller and smaller is going to trend towards 0. All right, of course, we can apply the same idea to sequences. So just to write this down for you, the sequence version would say, if the limit as n goes to infinity of a sub n is 0, and b sub n, let's say, is a bounded sequence for sufficiently large values of n, then the limit as n goes to infinity of the product of those two, that is the product of the one that goes to 0 and the one that's bounded, will always be 0. This is an important theorem and trick that we can apply in situations like this. And when I look at my example of a sub n equals sine squared n over 2 to the n, which of course is just sine squared n times 1 over 2 to the n, I recognize right away that the limit as n goes to infinity of 1 over 2 to the n is 0. And since I know the sine function, regardless of whether there's a square on it or not, or regardless of what this argument is, I know the sine function is always bounded by 1. In fact, with that square, I can actually say that sine squared n is greater than or equal to 0 and less than 1. Less than or equal to 1. So that means this part is bounded. It's never less than 0, it's never greater than 1, and the limit of this part is 0. Therefore, the product has a limit of 0. Okay, so important theorem to file away. You'll need to use this one once in a while. Okay, let's keep going and look at a few more. Let's look at a sub n equals n over n plus 1 to the n. And we probably don't need to do one like this, but I'll just throw another one like this in here just to remind you of the technique, since it's been a little while since you've used this. But of course, when I try to take the limit as n goes to infinity of n over n plus 1 to the n, I recognize that the limit as n goes to infinity of n over n plus 1 is 1, and so this is a 1 to the infinity form, so indeterminate. And I know the trick for those kinds of forms is to take the ln of that function that I'm trying to take the limit of. I'll take the limit of that ln, and if that limit exists, I'll raise e to that value, and that will be the limit of my original function, limit of the sequence. So in this course, in this case, I have the limit as n goes to infinity of n times the ln of n over n plus 1. Just to verify that this really is something to which I can apply L'Hopital's rule, the limit as n goes to infinity of this part is definitely infinity. the limit as n goes to infinity of this part. Well, as n goes to infinity, we already said this argument inside the log goes to 1. If that's approaching 1, then this is approaching ln of 1. Okay, what is ln of 1? That's 0. This is an infinity times 0 form. Okay, we recall the old trick. When we see an infinity times 0 form, we know that we can always reciprocate one of the functions or the other to turn this either into infinity over infinity or 0 over 0. Which one is more convenient? It's usually easier to reciprocate the simpler of the two functions. So I think I want to reciprocate the n. So that means now we're looking at the limit n goes to infinity ln of n over n plus 1 over 1 over n. I think I'm going to use log properties to simplify the numerator and make that ln of n minus ln of n plus 1. I'll take the derivatives of the top and the bottom. And of course, the top becomes 1 over n minus 1 over n plus 1. The bottom becomes negative 1 over n squared. If I clean that up a little bit and multiply top and bottom by negative n squared, looks like I'm going to get negative n squared over n plus n squared over n plus 1. Now if I want to, I can go ahead and put back in a common denominator. So this would give me limit n goes to infinity of n times n plus 1, which would be n squared plus n. And then the top would be negative n squared times n plus 1 plus n squared times n. So I think what we've got there is limit n goes to infinity of negative n cubed minus n squared plus n cubed, which means I think you have a negative n squared left there in that numerator, over n squared plus n. And at this point, I'm okay with you saying that that limit is negative 1, which you would get by two easy applications of L'Hopital's rule. Or I can just think back to Calc 1, where I realize this is a rational function, where the degrees of the top and the bottom are the same, which means the limit should be the ratio of the leading coefficients, which is negative 1. Okay, of course, what is our actual answer to the question? Since we did our log trick, now I need to raise e to that limit. So my answer is limit n goes to infinity of n over n plus 1 to the n is e to the negative 1. Okay, so nothing new there, just a refresher example similar to problems you did back in chapter 6. Okay, let's try this one. A sub n equals 10 over 11 to the n over 9 tenths to the n plus 11 twelfths to the n. Okay, now I'll leave it for you to see that applying L'Hopital's rule here will not really get you anywhere. That is, as n goes to infinity, you can definitely see that the limit of the top is 0, and the limits of each of these terms are also zeros. So this is a 0 over 0 form. But when you take the derivatives of the top and the bottom, well, what you get back when you take the derivative of the top is that same exponential function back multiplied by the log of 10 elevenths, which means, in essence, you don't really get rid of that function. And the same is going to happen when you take the derivative of each of those terms in the denominator. So L'Hopital's rule doesn't really work out too well with this one. So we'll have to try something else. You could try the sandwich theorem, Now, here's the thing with using the sandwich theorem. You do usually have to have some idea ahead of time about what you think the limit is. You have to make some conjecture so that you can try and compare this sequence to things whose behaviors you know. Okay, that means when I encounter a sequence like this where I'm not sure which approach to try, again, one of the first things I should try to do is maybe plot out a few values for this sequence. And in this case, since we're asking what the limit as n goes to infinity is, I should try to see, maybe on a calculator, what this thing evaluates to for some very large values of n. I won't do it here or list any values, but of course I'll just tell you that when you try some very large values of n, like n equals 1,000, n equals 10,000, n equals 1,000,000, the value of this function gets very, very close to zero. And of course that makes me conjecture that this limit may be zero. Now, since L'Hopital's doesn't work, I know I have the sandwich theorem. The other thing I can do before I start resorting to something like the sandwich theorem is I can just try to play with this thing to see if there's anything I can do with it. And in this case, if you look at what you've got here, so you've got 10 over 11 to the n over 9 over 10 to the n plus 11 over 12 to the n. There are a lot of things you could do to manipulate this. And I think when the author invented this problem, he was probably trying to get you to try a lot of different things if you didn't see immediately what you could do. And so there are a lot of things you could do. You could combine these two terms with a common denominator. You could multiply the whole thing by 10 to the n times 11 to the n times 12 to the n, and the top and the bottom. That would clear out all of the denominators. That would be getting rid of all the denominators, clearing those fractions. Okay, that's something you could try. Ultimately, it doesn't lead you anywhere very productive. What's another thing you could do? Well, I could certainly try to multiply some of these terms by reciprocals. And let's see, if I went right to this one, that is, I'm multiplying the top and the bottom by the reciprocal of this one. Now, why did I pick that one? Why not the 9 tenths? Why not the 10 elevenths? Well, let's see. For one thing, if I look at 10 elevenths and 9 tenths and 11 twelfths, is it clear, if you look at those values, that the smallest one is 9 tenths? The next biggest one is 10 elevenths, and the largest one is 11 twelfths. So you can check that for yourself on your calculator. That is the order from smallest to largest. Now, if I do multiply by 12 elevenths, and really I would arrive at this by a little bit of trial and error, what am I going to get when I multiply these two? Well, I'm going to get 10 times 12 to the nth over 11 times 11 to the nth. What am I going to get when I multiply those two? I'm going to get 9 times 12 to the n over 10 times 11 to the n. And of course, one of the big reasons I'm picking this reciprocal is to try and get one of these to cancel out. When I multiply these two, I'm definitely going to get 1. All right, what does that give me? It gives me 120 over 121 to the nth in the top. This term becomes 9 times 12, which is 108, over 10 times 11, which is 110 to the nth, plus 1. All right, now, question, what's the limit as n goes to infinity of 120 over 121 to the n over 108 over 110 to the n plus 1. Well, notice what I've created here. And I think I've got an extra 1 in there. notice what I've created here, and this will give you some idea about how I came up with this. I've created a fraction right here that's less than 1. And I've created another fraction here in the bottom that's also less than 1. What happens when you take a fraction that's less than 1, and then you raise it to the nth power, and you take the limit as n goes to infinity? Well, of course, we know the limit of such a function is 0. Now, if I had chosen to use a different reciprocal up here other than 12/11, I would have gotten myself in trouble if any of these fractions I created were larger than 1. Because if I had a fraction like 121 over 120 to the n, and I took the limit as n went to infinity of that, that would be divergent. So if I'm going to try and manipulate these fractions, part of my goal is to try and create fractions that are less than 1, so that when I raise them to the n and take the limit, I get 0. Okay, so I'll let you play with a few of the other combinations. So what would have happened up here if I had tried some of the other fractions? Well, you might get somewhere with some of them, but what you'll find is in most cases you keep running into some fractions that are bigger than 1. And if I'm trying to get this limit to be 0, this works out quite well, because this limit is 0, this limit is also 0, which means this limit is 0 over 0 plus 1, which is 0. So actually, we're done, because this limit of our original 10 over 11 to the n over 9 tenths to the n plus 11 twelfths to the n, well, I didn't really do anything fancy. There's no L'Hopital's rule. There's no sandwich theorem. I didn't even change this sequence. I just multiplied top and bottom by the same value. And that little bit of manipulation gives me an expression which is exactly the same as the one I started with. It just looks like a totally different form. And in fact, it's a form that when I take the limit, I get exactly 0. So the point of this example is sometimes you have to try some various manipulations or simplifications on the expression you've got without really doing anything else to it. So again, I didn't do any L'Hopital's rule, no sandwich theorem. I just modified this sequence to give me a form that actually led me towards the limit I thought this sequence has. And when I tried the 12/11, as I was trying a few of these things, I saw that it gave me a limit of 0 on the top, and I knew that was a good thing. Now, as long as that limit in the top is 0, and the limit of the bottom is not 0, which means the limit of the bottom could be finite, or it could be infinity. And so if the limit of the denominator had been either one of these things, I would still get my 0 answer. Well, in this case, the limit was finite. It was a limit of 1, because we had 0 over 1. So for a sequence like this, I think my point is there is no magic formula or magic template for all different sequences. Sometimes you just have to be creative and try to apply what you know from algebra and experiment a little bit. Let's try this one. A sub n equals n factorial over 2 to the n times 3 to the n. Now, the same thing I just said about the last example can often apply to sequences that contain factorials. Sometimes you just have to experiment. But in this case, I don't have to experiment. We already know what the answer is to this. We should. If we think about something we talked about in the last section, I know that if I multiply those two together, I get 6 to the n. And looking back to what we talked about in the last section, do you recall we proved that the limit as n goes to infinity of x to the n over n factorial is 0 for any real x? That was one of the last things we proved in the last video. Of course, this also means the limit as n goes to infinity of n factorial over x to the n equals infinity for any real x. Okay, and that's exactly what I have here. I have an n factorial on the top. I have an x to the n in the bottom, where x is 6. So I know the limit of this is infinity. Again, to solve this one, I'm pulling out a previous fact that we proved from section 8.1. So this is one of those common limits that shows up once in a while, so it's one that you keep handy to list in case you need to invoke it.